knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
As metaethical analysis gained popularity during the 20th century, the age-old ethical traditions in philosophy adapted to further situate themselves apart from the others. Additionally, several new schools of ethical thought emerged as new problems and solutions arose pertaining to moral issues. In this tutorial, we'll see how some metaethical theories developed from Moore's proposals, and the first ethical schools to resurge into prevalence within this new context, namely utilitarianism and Aristotle's heritage of virtue theory, as well as how they reformulated themselves in order to deal with metaethical issues. One of the first metaethical philosophers after Moore was Richard Hare, his contemporary. He defended a rationalist utilitarian prescriptivism, but borrowed much from other schools, such as emotivism and imperativism, based on Kant's categorical imperative, to shift the analytic debate over the reality of moral facts, which would invariably lead to relativism, or the know-how of moral action. For him, ethics should be interested in the logical analysis of the language of morality, and for that reason, he stresses the manner in which we should use the moral vocabulary. He was a non-cognitivist, meaning that the logical structure of moral sentences only expressed the preferences of the speaker, a perspective known as moral expressivism. Thus, his utilitarian perspective would be based on the preferences of individuals, which would be able to be, one, universalizable, since for him, normative words such as good or ought were analogous to a logical operator directed at everyone. Two, prescriptive, in that they suggest a model of action in given situations, such as how one should not kill, provides information on what to do, when in doubt as to whether to take someone else's life. And three, supervenience, or overriding, akin to Moore's conception of good, referring to how moral properties arise from non-moral ones, and also related to universalizability in that both are representable by a general ethical guidance as the golden rule instead of a fixed, inflexible moral norm. Bernard Williams, a student of Hare, was another analytic author influenced by the metaethical approach of Moore, directing strong criticism to any major philosophical theories attempting to create ethical norms. For him, moral life could not be systematized into any proper theory, as it wouldn't have any universal patterns or rules, and was inextricably conjoined with our diverse everyday experiences. Though he did not develop any theory himself, he approached ethical issues from a naturalist perspective, with the signature analytic anti-Platonic but also non-reductive standpoint. He differentiated between thick and thin ethical terms. Thick terms would have proper factual association, such as courage, lie, brutality, and such, and thus can approach a version of truth, since they could be analyzed and compared with real criteria for success, given their cultural relevance. Thin moral concepts, on the other hand, would only engender generic, weak terminology, such as right, bad, and ought, which, akin to Moore's perspective, could not be identified with anything other than subjective variable positions, thus differing in kind with thick ones. Therefore, a semblance of a structure of morality is a linguistic one relating to speakers in a community. If that community ceases to exist, so does the specificity of these thick values. For this, he thoroughly criticizes Kantian and deontological theories in general for attempting to delineate static principles detached from social contexts. Furthermore, and in stark contrast with Moore, he doubles down on his criticism of utilitarianism as it attempts to further systematize ethics into a cold, impersonal calculus with a supposed authority on our moral feelings. He thus distinguishes between morality, or these limited approaches to human action, from ethics, which encompasses his holistic perspective of human experience. While Moore and Hare, like Sidgwick and others of this time, defined their moral theory under utilitarianism, the person who coined the widespread term consequentialism was Gertrude Margaret Anscombe. A student of Wittgenstein, she focused on the metaethical task of analyzing a theory of action or understanding how human behavior occurs before presenting a moral theory of norms. She concerned herself with the matter of intention in her early philosophical career, and thus, akin to Williams, later denounced theories such as consequentialism for focusing on the results, lacking any regard to the means by which they are reached, and also deontological theories which focus on obligations, and thus a kind of authority, becoming a legalistic approach without regard for the individual actions and perspectives of given situations. With this, another important expression she did not create but helped bring back into contemporary relevance is virtue ethics. One option of an ethical model which would encompass the whole of human moral psychology and general nature, cultural relevance, and definition of thick ethical concepts is Aristotle's virtue theory. Though terms such as flourishment, as used by Aristotle, could possibly have no fixed definition, it denoted something more fulfilling than just pleasure, as the consequentialists defined, and had greater empirical support for thick moral concepts than the thin ones used in the other theories, giving due weight to the agent's intention and also dealing better with moral issues without falling into the danger of doing evil things for good results, or the incoherence of one self-judging one's own obligations. English philosopher Philippa Foot was directly influenced by this perspective and Anscombe's overall arguments, developing and further spreading the study of virtue theory. She also was concerned with the whole picture of how morality takes place, and wrote a stark criticism of the supremacy of rationality in ethical discourse. She compares moral oughts to rules of etiquette, which, though different in kind, work similarly in a linguistic and social context, as one ought to act in a certain way in order to not be socially frowned upon, either by, for example, not dressing adequately in formal attire, or murdering someone. However, one can knowingly act ignoring both kinds of rules, and have reasons to do so, either because they want to make a social statement in the first case, for example, or because taking the life of someone will prevent them from doing further harm. The grammatical use of concepts like ought or should then hold no infallible indication of behavior, as they may be applied in both moral and non-moral contexts. Rationality, then, is not a necessary prerequisite for following any kind of norm. This does not remove the objectivity of morality for Foot, as though emotions play a much larger role than reason could in moral contexts, she defends a cognitivism of moral judgments, since ethical utterances express an assessment of an interconnection between our physical nature, psychology, and the social context. Moral words, similarly to the later Wittgenstein, have no meaning if they are not emotionally shared with like-minded individuals in a social context. One cannot be bad if only a single person espouses an exotic definition. Virtue theory, then, as with Anscombe, would fare better when dealing with morality, since it would respect the entirety of the moral phenomenon, though for her, flourishment is definable as good, as it can only exist when shared with other human beings. She is primarily known for creating the trolley problem thought experiment, which is discussed in the psychology series, where a runaway trolley is going uncontrollably fast in the direction of five people working on the tracks, and you know an accident will be fatal to all of them. You, however, can flip a switch to change tracks where only one worker would necessarily be killed by the trolley. The consequentialist argument would support flipping the switch to be the morally better option. She presents this to contrast with a rescue scenario where you're on a jeep and are able to rescue five stranded people before a tide comes, however would necessarily have to run over and kill someone else in the way, an option that most would refrain from. She uses this example while writing in Applied Ethics to differentiate between negative rights, which refer to one's passive rights of existing and non-interference, and positive rights, which have an obligatory force onto others to provide help or other services. In the trolley scenario, it reads as morally permissible, for there are less negative rights being violated, while in the rescue one, a negative right would be sacrificed toward five positive rights. This would illustrate that negative rights are more important than positive ones in her theory. Finally, following their footsteps, Alasdair MacIntyre criticizes consequentialist and deontological theories for not dealing with the emotivist picture of the world one arrives at by analyzing the emotional and social importance of ethical practice. He began as a Marxist, attempting to conciliate with a condemnation of Stalinism, an endeavor which failed, and he proceeded to abandon this school, accusing it of defending a version of Kantian ethics, or utilitarianism, thus moving on toward virtue ethics. His meta-ethical analysis is brief, as he intends to produce a proper ethical theory based not mainly in Aristotle, but rather in Aquinas' formulation, since it focuses on self-examination and reflection toward identifying guiding principles, calling the other two ethical traditions a technical approach to moral philosophy lacking proper morality. From his political background, he considers liberalism a fourth recent tradition in ethics. For him, it would be an abstract, generic, rational theory of values, attempting to deviate from all traditions, and yet still having all of their traits. That is, pragmatically utilizing moral terminology for controlling the people toward the maintenance of capitalism. He defends a communitarist perspective as per his social understanding of moral virtues, further intertwining his ethical and political theories. Clearly, the meta-ethical revolution brought on at the beginning of the 20th century directly influenced how moral philosophy was constructed, shedding new light on age-old philosophical issues. In the next and final tutorial on contemporary ethics, we'll take a look at how deontology dealt with the new meta-ethical subjects and other interesting concepts relevant to ethical debate.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.